And you have to have a strategy to present your brand to the public. Keep in mind, everybody, the public is just inundated with everybody's brands. So how do you stand out? And again, you want to be controversial enough so they say, oh, let's interview this person, because that's an unusual take that that person has on blah, blah, blah. You want to make your statement as captivating as possible about who you are, your statement. So I wrote down 10 brand strategy questions that I included in the book, but we ought to talk about that.
Okay.
First, everybody has to answer, who is your target audience?
You know, that's really important, because this morning alone, I'm teaching an entrepreneurship course. That's the first thing I said. I said, who are you selling your product to? And because they're creating a company. And one of the students looked at me and he said he wanted to make computers, do certain things. And I said, okay, well, who are you selling it to? Are you selling it to students? Are you selling it to people who have computer knowledge, who don't have computer knowledge? And I was saying how some people even create pictures of their customers and put them around them, so that when they're developing their ideas and they're looking at their customers and going, huh, okay, so I'm speaking to men, or I'm speaking to young kids, or I'm speaking to, you know, and you have to really have an idea of who you're speaking to and who's going to buy what you're selling.
You know, it sounds so basic.
It does.
Somebody asked me, somebody who wants to be a writer or wanted to be a writer at the time, said to me, look, I just wrote this short story. Would you read it? Knowing that I'm a writer. Mm-hmm. So I said, sure. So before I even opened it, I said, just tell me, who is your audience? He said, what difference does that make? Mm-hmm. He had no idea. This is a brilliant guy. He had no idea.
That's self-publishing. You're getting more people thinking that way because they don't have agents telling them they have to create the pitch, you know, like we used to in the past. And so I think that's a big thing. I mean, think of the book, what are they, proposals that we used to write, the big 20 pages, 100 pages, depending on what it was. Yeah. You would create all these things and you would do an analysis of the market and you would show who your competitors were and why your book's different, how many pages your book would be compared to theirs. I mean, you did a deep analysis, right?
It had to be extraordinary research on your part.
Right.
As a matter of, and then you collected all of your credentials and the agent that I had in New York said, I have never seen the book proposal so small in comparison to the amazing press kit that you have.
Yeah.
And I've never seen this before because I had so much press. But you have to understand, you are selling your brand. Mm-hmm. And if you don't sell it, why should anybody buy it?
I think going through that book proposal thing was probably one of the better experiences for me. To recognize the kinds of things that people are looking for to when you're pitching anything in general, because you learn how to look at competition, you learn how to understand market segments. There's just so much of the business aspect that a lot of people don't like the business aspect. They don't want to think about that stuff.
The moment you get out there in the public eye, you are an entity. You want to call it a business? Fine. You want to call it a book? Fine. You want to call it a lawyer, a doctor, or whatever. But you can call it anything you want. It is nonetheless a business. And you have to know your audience. And you have to know, okay, the second one, what are their pain points?
What are you solving?
Yeah, okay. So the third one is what audience action or transformation are you seeking?
Right.
Just for you to get up and talk bloody.
Yeah, you get up there and you throw up all your words and then they leave and they don't have anything that they can do with any of that. It's no good.
Keep in mind that this is a running theme throughout my book. Everybody has to feel that spending time with you is creating value for them.
Well, if you try to be a speaker at just about any convention, anything where you have to put in a proposal, they will ask you to give a short paragraph about what you're going to talk about, but they also want you to give them the takeaways, things that they're going to be able to change and do from what they're going to learn. And so going through that is really important. Maybe for those of you listening who are thinking of becoming speakers, go through some of those speaker applications and see the kinds of things that they want you to fill out, so you know the kinds of things you need to incorporate in your talks. Because if you're not incorporating takeaways and what the actionable things that they can do, then you're not setting up your speech right.
That's right. So you have to have, number four is, what is your brand message? Number five is, what is your offer? What are you offering them? Remember, you start out looking at an audience, a sea of faces, and think of them all saying, ho-hum.
What's in it for me? They're all thinking that.
That's right. Ho-hum. Why should I bother listening? What's in it for me? What is this person going to give to me? Mm-hmm. It's not about you and your delivery as much as it is about the audience. So stop getting uptight about speaking in public. They don't give a hoot about you. They care about what you're giving to them. Okay, how do you plan to interact, and on which platforms? And every platform is different, and you have to determine that. I started doing a taping for a New York television show, and I started out with my green screen that you so brilliantly created for me.
For the background.
Uh-huh. And as soon as I got on, and since it was only a tape, he was able to say, and he said, we don't do green screens here. I said, okay. So I turned off the Zoom and I walked the green screen away and I changed the settings on my Zoom, and we were just as we are right this minute. So you have to be able to change just like this, and you don't know what their preferences are for their particular platform.
You know, that's funny, because I think I might have told you this and I can't remember, but I was at an event where Joe Polish was interviewing Naveen Jain, the billionaire behind Viome and Moon Express and all that. And Joe started with his iPad looking at him, and he was going to ask him questions he had. And Naveen took the thing and just threw it across the room. And it was like, and Joe's cute because he's like, you think I need that? I don't need that. You know, like, you called out the elephant in the room that, you know, and but it was great.
That he went with the flow.
You have to.
Somebody who has not been trained might have said, oh my God, what am I going to do?
Right.
I remember somebody who's on a news show today who had gotten up. This was before she ended up on this news show as an anchor. And she was preparing a speech, and she had all these papers like that. All of a sudden, a wind came, and she was so debilitated. Uh-huh. She lost the election because of that.
Mm.
People thought, she doesn't know what she's talking about. Okay, so what is the point of purchase? If you're selling a product, what is your timeline? And in terms of voting for people, there is a specific timeline, and these people better get ready now, because this is not, you know, like this, snap your finger, and they're going to be
transformed. You're talking about politicians speaking?
I'm talking about politicians. How will you measure your progress? So, I thought I did well. Really? Where's the measurement? Is it quantitative? Is it qualitative? Let's not get statistically with those words. But honestly, you have to have determined in advance what the measurement will be. So after the fact, you walk off and you can use that.